Welcome back to the Electronics Inside, the show where we tear down tools, toys and appliances just to find out what's inside. I'm David, and in this episode we've actually been sent a piece of equipment straight from a manufacturer just to see what's inside. Let's get on with it. I should probably open up by explaining this is not a product review. I'm woefully underqualified to talk about a fitness and activity tracking watch. I've worn a smartwatch every day pretty much since 2013 or so, so I feel like I could talk about the smart features, but a fitness tracking watch, it's not really my thing. But what we can talk about is the electronics inside. So let's flip this over and work out how to get inside. Nice, easily removable, clicky watch straps, although that looks like it's got the same pins as a normal 22mm, 21mm watch strap. Should be fairly straightforward. I mean, Fēnix 7S Solar. That's such an interesting little feature to add to a smartwatch because battery life is a big consideration for wearables, and it's one of the things I place very highly. And I think this little bezel around the outside edge is actually the solar cell. And they give estimations on how long it'll run for and how much extra charge you can get by wearing it out in the sun. And I just find it really odd that they specify it at 50,000 lux, which in the context of an office, you probably design that between 350 and 450 lux at working level. So that'll give you an idea of how bright 50,000 lux is. That said, a moderately sunny day is like 10,000 lux, so 50,000 isn't that much of an exaggeration. I'm trying to work out which Torx bit I need before I try and take these screws out and absolutely strip the heads. There you go, that feels about right. That is a T5 for anybody keeping score. This has got a mixture of stainless steel. You can actually see there it says 516L stainless steel, 100 meters waterproof, which is a nice feature. You could take this diving, I guess. Power glass. I'm guessing that's something to do with the solar, the photovoltaics. It's got a military standard, and this is the 42mm body size. And I understand, although some of this is metal, actually the plastic bits around the top, they describe as fiber reinforced polymer, which could be GRP, glass reinforced plastic, could be PA6, PA66. And one thing I do like about the design of this watch, so you see the pins are actually recessed here. So the little charging port magnetically catches on the back, but you actually have to insert that. I had a previous smartwatch where those pins were flush with the back, and I found that general dirt, grime, skin sort of started almost corroding the contacts. So these little pogo pins should be much better protected from that. But I guess you'd have to be careful that this little bit here doesn't fill up with dirt to prevent charging. I don't know, because there's screws up there as well. That looks like it would take the bezel off. Ooh, that's very different assembly to what I was expecting. Let's see if we can pop open the connectors to the display and the digitizer, because this is a touchscreen watch. Got a pair of high density connectors there. Got another two Torx inside here, and is that an RF shield or is that a heat spreader? And what looks like maybe another connector in that corner up there. So we'll sort of tread carefully around that for the time being. Although something I'm a big fan of is they've used the same size Torx bit throughout so far. That always makes me feel good. That connecting the heart rate sensor and the blood pressure sensor on the back. What I'm not sure is how the buttons interface with the PCB. Do they go in, out? Do the buttons have to be removed out the side first? Don't think that's gonna fit down the PCB. This connector actually runs through to the back. If I wiggle the back, you can see that sort of moves. And I don't think it'll fit down the side of the PCB with the PCB still in place. So I need to see if I can get that out. Last little bit of elastic. So, oh, that genius. Couple little pogo pins on there. And each of the buttons is actually fitted to the case, but they've got these little sort of gold-plated pins that press against sort of plated PCB edges, which is just a great touch. So this just presses in and makes contact with all those double poles from the buttons. And at the top, could be the battery connector. So obviously we've got battery built into the bottom. Here we go. Wow, it looks like a little piezo on the inside there. But there is a lot crammed into a very small space there. So that center is, well, right, I guess, in the center of the watch. So as much as I brought the camera down pretty much as low as I can, and I shoot in 4K, that's still not good enough for you to be able to see everything on here. So let's get the microscope out, then we can all have a really good look. Well, let me just say there are some treats for you in here. First of all, let me show you what we're working with by using a standard banana for scale. Or perhaps more usefully, I'll set my calipers up for a millimeter and you can see what that looks like. Crazy, right? So anyway, let's go down the ICs that I found and you can have a look with me so we can understand what we're looking at. So first of all, let's start on the back and just have a very quick look here because it's a very strange kind of construction and I'm not really sure why. On the rear, it's mostly passives. And we've also got the other sprung pins which connect to the throughputs from the cable for charging. But you've also got sort of these connections which potted sections to it, and I can't quite work out why. They are well and truly stuck on, and I don't know whether they're covering components or whether they're covering external traces, not quite bodge wires, but like traces which didn't fit onto the PCB. They make these very distinct black shapes all over, and I can't quite work out why. So if we now flip over to the front side where all the good stuff is, right front and center, we've got an NXP MR T595SFFOC, which is, of course, the system on a chip. And this one crams a lot in. So we've got an IMX RT500 crossover MCU with ARM Cortex M33, DSP and GPU. Not really sure what they're using the GPU for. I know it's got a display, but I can't imagine that uses big GPU power. That could be driven by a CPU with a display driver. But it's got the GPU capability. And yeah, it's an impressive thing for a little package. Looking around, we've also got another little partner NXP chip down here. And that one appears to be a machine learning coprocessor. Again, I'm not sure within the scope of this product what they're using machine learning for, but I'm impressed all the same. So up the top, this Max 20360 is actually the power management chip. Now that handles all of the voltage leveling, voltage stabilization, battery power control and charging. And that's an impressive little package. And it can do 1.5 watts, which sounds like nothing, but when you consider the size of the battery and the power you're working with here, that's tons. 1.5 watts is way overpowered for this, I imagine. Okay, in this corner, there's that other chip here, Aurora Technology AG3335NM. Now that's a multi-band GPS receiver. Now this is a multi-band GPS chip, because when you think of GPS, most people probably still think it's like a single system. There is one network of satellites. Well, actually that's not quite true. GPS is the old American one, which is sort of seeded from the military. I think there's also GLONASS, which was sort of a Russian pan-European one, and I think there's Galileo as well, and they all provide the same technology but use different frequencies and different mathematics and different setups to achieve the same purpose. Now using multi-band GPS, you can use any satellites in combination and work out even better where you are. I think traditional GPS you had to have, was it 5 satellites for a position, 7 for an improved accuracy position. Multiband, you can use satellites from any constellation to derive your position to higher accuracy. And for fitness and tracking and things like that, that makes a lot of sense that you'd want that on board. Okay, so we've got up here the Silicon Industries chip. Now that Silicon Industries chip is providing the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth connectivity on this smartwatch. If you can identify any of the ICs on here which I haven't managed to find data sheets for, let me know over at the Element 14 community at element14.com/theelectronicsinside. It's the best place to reach out to me directly. Okay, and the biggest IC left on here is the eMMC storage by a company called FORESEE. And I'd never heard of FORESEE before, but Longsys, their parent company, have just bought out Lexar, who I do know from computer storage and things like that. But this IC, I mean, it looks enormous when you compare it to all the others, but if you compare this to other 32 gig eMMC storage solutions, it's tiny. It's a fifth thinner, so it goes from a millimetre in the normal package to 0.8 millimetres thick. And it's reduced the footprint to almost the same size as the BGA ball grid array that it connects to the motherboard using. And I hear that in total, it's like 40% of the total volume of other equivalents. And when you're dealing with an IC this big, that is impressive. Having the opportunity to look inside a smartwatch has been really revealing to me. I kind of thought that the massive manufacturing task, like the complexity of Swiss watches or those archetypal, wonderful, like the inside of a Rolex, would somehow translate into a smartwatch. And it's not. With a smartwatch, the design, the integration of those packages onto this tiny little circuit board, it's really clever at design stage, but in terms of production, it shouldn't really be any more complicated than most sized PCBs. I'm sure it comes with its own challenges, but the manufacturing is just cleverly done. It should be reasonably straightforward. And this is the first time I've seen inside a smartwatch, and I thought it was interesting. I'm very interested to see inside some other smartwatches to see how they all compare. Do they all look like the Garmin, or have they all made other sacrifices to achieve that smaller package? I think it would be great fun to see another smartwatch from another manufacturer, or with maybe a different focus, less smart tracking one, maybe one with a little different focus on compact form factor, for example. If you think that'd be an interesting one, why don't you head over to the Element 14 community at element14.com/theelectronicsinside and let me know. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.